Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Susan Bennett, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Understanding Democracy in America. Your professor will be Ken Masugi. Ken Masugi combines academic depth in the study of politics with practical experience in the world of politics. Dr. Masugi teaches political science for Johns Hopkins University's Center for Advanced Governmental Studies and Ashland University's John M. Ashbrook Center. He also taught at the U.S. Air Force Academy as John M. Olin Distinguished Visiting Professor. He is editor of the acclaimed Interpreting Tocqueville's Democracy in America and author of a forthcoming book on Democracy in America. In addition to his scholarship, Masugi has had an extensive career in public affairs, having served as a speechwriter to two members of President George W. Bush's cabinet and a special assistant to other agency heads, including Clarence Thomas. He is a senior fellow of the Claremont Institute and contributes to the Liberty Fund website, libertylawsite.org. And now we begin Understanding Democracy in America. Lecture 1. Tocqueville's Amazing and Enduring Insights.
In a world in which we're so distracted by the headlines, by cable news, by tweets, and so on, it may be difficult to appreciate a great book like Tocqueville's Democracy in America. A great book is one that teaches thoughtful human beings over the ages. It is not intended to be an editorial or to even to offer policy guidance on a particular pressing problem of the day. A great book is intended to deepen our understanding of human beings so that we can better understand what we're about, so that we can better appreciate the complexities of moral, political, and intellectual life. And Tocqueville's Democracy in America, in that sense, is perhaps the greatest book ever written on democracy. Some people will claim it's the greatest book ever written on America. And certainly it makes a very plausible case for both of those seemingly impossible claims. And the claims become all the more striking when we consider that Tocqueville was a Frenchman, a French aristocrat, who visited America for about 9 months in 1831 through 1832. And then he wrote two volumes, one in 1835, which was instantly praised, and then a second volume in 1840. In English translation, the two volumes come out to about 700 pages, and they present an extraordinary insight into the nature of America. And why do we still bother to read this book? Well, some very thoughtful people think we should, demonstrated by the fact that since the year 2000, five different English translations of the book have appeared. Five different ones. And they all add something to the literature on Tocqueville, and each of them is justified in its own way. Well, let's talk about Tocqueville and why this book is so extraordinary. And then we'll talk a little about Tocqueville's life, and our individual lectures will discuss different facets of Tocqueville's insights into America. I won't refer to specific page numbers since you'll all be using different editions of the book. I do have my preferred editions, the University of Chicago edition by Harvey Mansfield Jr. is the one that I prefer using. Other people prefer other editions, such as, for example, the Library of America edition, which has just come out and which is bilingual. So I'm going to use a variety of editions in my discussion here. I will lay out for you some of the most important quotations. I'll correct them according to my reading of the French, and then we'll go on our way. Tocqueville had extraordinary insights into America, which is why we can still read a book that's well over 170 years old and still think that he's talking about us today. And we need to think about not just who this extraordinary man Tocqueville was, but who we are as a people. Why is it that close to two centuries later, Tocqueville still gets us right? As we Americans worry about our future, as we become more pessimistic or optimistic about how things will turn out, we return to the very same questions this French visitor raised over 170 years ago. He portrayed an America full of energy, full of confidence that they could use their liberty in ways that would enhance their lives. We recognize the types of people that Tocqueville sketches: pioneers, clergymen, entrepreneurs, immigrants, civic activists, philanthropic causes, racial division, all that's good and bad in America, Tocqueville touched on. And he did it not simply as a tourist, but as a scholar as well. And he sees contemporary America in the Americans he saw, in the inattentiveness of Americans as we text and multitask. He saw the strength of American women in a way that his contemporaries may have been puzzled at. And he saw, as well as we do, the kinds of blowhards and demagogues we spot in our politics today, the fakeness, the rush, the chaotic sort of life we live, especially in the electronic media. And Tocqueville anticipated all of this. And our judgment is supported by great thinkers like John Stuart Mill, the English philosopher of liberty, who reviewed both volumes of Tocqueville's Democracy in America and pronounced it a work which will never be exceeded. The great American historian Henry Adams regarded his life and works as the gospel of my private religion, and so on. And so it went until the centennial of Tocqueville's book, when another great scholar of Tocqueville, George Pearson, compared it to the greatest works of American, English, and French political insight. What we find is Tocqueville describing great types of Americans, like the pioneer, who he says is a very civilized man, who for a time submits to living in the middle of the woods and who plunges into the wilderness of the New World with his Bible and axe and newspapers. All is primitive and savage around him, but he is, so to speak, the result of 18 centuries of work and experience. And so we have this pioneer. We think of a Daniel Boone, or in fiction, Natty Bumppo, who nonetheless has with him a Bible. That is, he thinks about what is transcendent, an axe for the purposes of reducing the wilderness around him, and also as a weapon, but also newspapers. That is, he's not solely isolated. He's a person who expects to be a part of society. He's interested in politics. He's interested in the equivalent of garage sales, and he wants to know what's going on all around him. And Tocqueville comes to know we Americans. He sees in democracy this restlessness and an enormous, superabundant force of energy. And he's constantly surprised at what ordinary people can do. They use their liberty so well, these Americans. They don't require government to be there, although they do govern themselves. They use the laws. But they are constantly working by themselves, for themselves. And he is not simply heaping praise upon us. He's very critical of us as well. He thinks that our national government has a lot of problems that are endemic to democracy. He notes that the habit of inattention is the greatest vice of the American mind, of the democratic mind. We're multitaskers, we Americans, and we don't do things really as well as we should, precisely because we're trying to do too many things at once. And yet that's one of the charms of American society, all the different ways in which our energy goes. If Tocqueville were to look at our society today, he'd say, yes, there's a lot of what he wrote about still here. And there are many things as well that would disturb him, tendencies in our society that would alarm him, in fact. And we're going to explore all of these things. And Democracy in America sounds like a government textbook, but it's the farthest thing from that, because politics is only a part of what he means by democracy. He's talking about the culture of a democracy. That is to say, what develops our democracy in terms of government, laws, political parties, and other distinctly political practices. Tocqueville, you might think of as kind of a portrait painter of democracy. He will add a splash of color here, a line here, a horizon there, and after a while, it will all pull together as a grand portrait of a people. And this is a dynamic portrait. Tocqueville is not simply trying to be a journalist. He's not a poll taker. He reaches for something we might call the soul of democracy, our nature as Americans. And it's that that he is able to bring forth in extraordinary detail. To be appreciative of Tocqueville, to be a Tocquevillian, does not mean to adhere rigidly to every single insight he had, because as you'll see, he does make mistakes. But even the mistakes he makes are interesting and highly instructive. To be a Tocquevillian means to ask the right questions. That is what a great book does, and that's what Democracy in America does. It forces us to ask the right questions about what it means to be a free citizen of a democracy. And what that in turn requires us to do is think about all the political institutions, the government, but even more important, what makes those institutions work. And that means the intellectual background of Americans, the religious background, the culture, the relative degree of prosperity, the traditions, the expectations, what Tocqueville calls the mores. That is, who are these people? They didn't just come out of nowhere. They came out of a certain tradition, as Tocqueville said about the pioneer. 18 centuries of experience produced this pioneer. So perhaps the best way to get into the book is simply to turn to the table of contents, which Tocqueville annotates in a very thorough way. And you're going to find two volumes of roughly equal length. You're going to find 10 chapters, lengthy ones, in the first volume. And you're going to find four parts of roughly 40 chapters each in the second volume. Now, in the second volume, the chapters are extremely short. Some of them are so short they remind you of aphorisms or parables. And Tocqueville's method of teaching varies somewhat in the two books. The first book is more historical. He's more interested in the particular practices of the American people. And it's, in a sense, it's much more optimistic about the future of America. There are some very serious problems he highlights as well. The second volume has a sprightly quality about it. Tocqueville appears to jump from topic to topic, cultural issues, the nature of American language, of democratic language, the various conflicts that can occur. He seems to be deeply pessimistic in some parts of the book. the great threat for Tocqueville is bureaucracy. And that seems surprising to us, because what bureaucracy was there in the 1840s? Well, we'll get into that. That's a very important issue. But how he anticipated the growth of bureaucracy in the 21st and late 20th and early 21st centuries is something very striking, and perhaps the greatest political insight of his book, of how it is that bureaucracy arises in our lives today. To give you an idea of how striking Tocqueville is, there's one quotation at the very end of Volume 1 that strikes people in particular. And he's talking about the future of the world. Remember, writing in 1835. He singles out two nations that strike him as ones that will define the future of the world. And he notes America, but he also notes Russia. The American, he says, struggles against the obstacles that nature opposes to him. The adversaries of the Russians are men. The former combats the wilderness and barbarism, the latter civilization with all its arms. The conquests of the Americans are therefore gained by the plowshare, those of the Russians by the sword. The Anglo-American relies upon personal interest to accomplish his ends and gives free scope to the unguided strength and common sense of the people. The Russian centers all the authority of society in a single arm. The principal instrument of the former is freedom, of the latter, servitude. Their starting point is different, and their courses are not the same, yet each of them seems marked out by the will of heaven to sway the destinies of half the globe. So there you have Tocqueville in 1835 predicting the split of the world between the Russians and the Americans. That vision of the world, which seemed to be so confirmed by the Cold War, may not have the resonance it has for some of you older auditors who lived through the Cold War and saw the struggle between Russia and America. But Tocqueville knew something about the character of nations. Although he never returned to America throughout his life, he was always interested in American things. So let's then talk a little about Tocqueville's life, just to give you an idea of Tocqueville's extraordinary insight into the nature of the world. Consider what he wrote at the very end of Volume 1, which came out in 1835. And he sees the future of the world being defined by two people, one the Americans, the other the Russians. All other nations, he says, seem to have reached their natural limits and have only to maintain their power. But these alone are proceeding with ease along a path to which no limit can be perceived. The American struggles against the obstacles that nature opposes to him. The adversaries of the Russians are men. The former combats the wilderness and savage life, the latter civilization with all its arms. The conquests of the American are therefore gained by the plowshare, those of the Russian by the sword. The Anglo-American relies upon personal interest to accomplish his ends and gives free scope to the unguided strength and common sense of the people. The Russian centers all the authority of society in a single arm. The principal instrument of the former is freedom, of the latter, servitude. Their starting point is different, and their courses are not the same. Yet each of them seems marked out by the will of heaven to sway the destinies of half the globe. And so there you have Russia and America dividing the world between them. He doesn't say that they will come to war, but those of us who are old enough to have lived through the Cold War find the passage chilling, because it really tells us that the fate of the world is to be decided by people who believe that common sense, individual freedom are the best way to have a future on Earth. The other alternative is all power in one individual. And to a certain extent, that becomes the struggle for Americans today, is how much power will they give to centralized bureaucracy? How much power will the people themselves retain? Well, we need to turn to Tocqueville himself. Who is this person who had all these extraordinary insights? He was the son of two great French aristocratic families, and in fact, those families nearly met their death just an evening away from the guillotine. His great-grandparents were executed, in fact. They fell to the guillotine. His father almost met that fate, having witnessed the slaughter of much of the rest of his family. And, of course, the experience remained with Tocqueville. Recall that the French Revolution was the world's premier event in terms of revolutions until the great revolutions of the 20th century that resulted in World War II. And so Tocqueville writes with a memory, a family memory, of what can happen when democratic revolutions go badly. And I think an excellent summary of the French Revolution, if you don't have the basic events in mind, is that provided by a YouTube video by a group called the History Teachers. And it's simply called French Revolution. And it's very entertaining, but also historically very instructive. But again, our purpose in reading Tocqueville is not simply to read American history, although it does. The book does present a great portrait of that time. Remember, Andrew Jackson was president. He makes a brief mention of Jackson. And we learn a great deal about the customs of the time, about women, about slaves, about the commercial life, about high society, and about average, ordinary Americans. The character of Tocqueville's book and how it can inform us today is best seen if you look at the very first sentence and the very last sentence of the book. He begins, very first sentence, "Among the new objects that attracted my attention during my stay in the United States, none struck my eye more vividly than the equality of conditions." The equality of conditions. At the very end of the book, he says, "The nations of our time cannot prevent the conditions of men from becoming more equal, but it depends upon themselves whether the principle of equality is to lead them to servitude or freedom, to knowledge or barbarism, to prosperity or wretchedness." So Tocqueville begins the book with a view of equality of conditions as having great promise. And at the end, he says, well, equality, it could mean slavery or freedom. It could mean knowledge or barbarism or prosperity or misery. Well, which is it? And this is how Tocqueville is so instructive, in that he takes concepts that we love dearly, equality, liberty or freedom, democracy, and he shows that in fact, what we value so much needs to be thought out. Otherwise, we fool ourselves. Equality, as he notes at the end of the book, and this is what his elaborate portrait unveils to us, equality is ambiguous. It can be for good, it can be for ill. We can use our liberty in foolish ways. We can think we're being free when, in fact, we're becoming more unfree, more dependent, more restricted in what we can become and do. And why is it, though, that he even speaks of an equality of conditions? Obviously, Tocqueville knew about slaves, and he regarded slaves as equal people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.